Let's stand together and let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please stay standing as we confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. And I'll add to our previous prayer of praise God that we are so close to the hospital and emergency medical services can get here so quickly. And so praise God for that and for them. And so I'm going to turn it over to Chris here. So.
Actually, we take the offering?
Oh, yes. So the ushers are going to come around with the offering trays to collect today's offering. So.
And we will share a special music at this time, too. This is called Amazed, and it does go along with our sermon text today, which we've read already, so I won't reread that, but let's just worship in this special music time. You sing all around.
the many good things, the blessings and gifts we enjoy in life. Please receive these gifts. May they be used for your kingdom, for the spread of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to help those in need. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. And as it is the second Sunday of the month, it's our tradition here to have in our worship time, song time, to have a hymn sing, so where you can pick any hymn out of the hymnal and call it out to Chris and he'll play it. So, so yes. Take
555. Let's do any particular verses you're thinking. Let's do all three. How about 1 and 3? Let's do 1 and 3. Okay, 582. Let's do 582. "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus." How about verses 1 and 4?
We have to do 1 and 3.
Yes, let's do 1 and 3. Thank you. like to say my short-term memory was really great, but I had an extra tape flag calling, so 526, correct? Turn your eyes upon Jesus and 1 and 2. Blessed assurance.
What was that?
1 and 3 sounds good.
Thank you.
And have a little interruption in our bulletin here. We're going to have, this last week we had Vacation Bible School for the kids in our congregation. And so we're going to invite some of them up here and just to kind of show off some of the crafts and things they made. You probably could tell from the decorations, our theme was heroes of the faith. And so I think I do see some of the Ritters, but I don't know if any of their kids who came with us are willing to come up here today. But so there we go. And I'll have my boys come up. And this is about half, or we had about 9 or 10 kids here today, so are over in VBS here, and so we'll show them. They want to show off some of the things they made at VBS here. So come on up. So Evan, we had them all make capes and paint their own capes, because superhero capes, of course. So Evan has his cape. Each one of them had their name printed on, and then they also made birdhouses, which I don't know if those are. There we go. We have a birdhouse here to show off. They all got to paint their own birdhouses. So. Okay. All right. Well, thank you for coming up here. You guys, you go be seated here. So, maybe we do have one more coming here, maybe. She might be a little shy, and that's okay. We'll let her. Hey, Elise, do you want to show off your birdhouse? Come here, Simeon. Come here. You can show it. Ready? Oh, there you go. Show it off. I'm being orbited by a bird. All right, you guys, you can go to the nursery. Oh, I gotta run the service, buddy. You gotta go to the nursery, okay? Not today, buddy. Not today. Simeon James. Yeah, you do get me escorting you to it. Let's go. I'll be right back. Well, our service today has been slightly irregular, but it's actually very fitting with our message because it's entitled to Know the Love of Christ. But one of the things we're really talking about in this passage is inner strength. We've been in a series on Ephesians, the book of Ephesians. We took a little break because I had a baby due. So we had guest pastors covering for me for a bit. But now we're back into it, and we're back in, and we're coming into Ephesians chapter 3. And as we read earlier, we read the prayer for inner strength, Paul's prayer for inner strength for believers. And inner strength, we know, is essential for so many things. When we are faced with difficult things, when we're faced with the reality of our mortality, when we're faced with temper tantrums, all these things, like we're faced with things that test our nerve. And as I was thinking about this, I thought of, you know, one of my favorite stories of a test of nerve comes from the movie The Big Country, which is an old cowboy western. And I'll try it simply as possible. Near the end of the movie, there is a duel, a classic duel. And on the one side is the hero, pictured here. And he is an unexpected hero. He's the outsider in this distant western town, ranch town. He doesn't behave the way they think he should behave. These are all tough guys and he doesn't fight when they expect him to fight. But the truth is, it's not because he can't fight. It's because he has self-control. He knows his own worth. He can't be goaded or manipulated into a fight that's not his. And so throughout the movie, he faces all sorts of things, adversity, mocking, even beatings, and he does it unflinching. doesn't shy away from any of it, but he rarely ever gets lured in to the fight itself. There's this great moment where his fiancée, that's why he's in this town, she's asking him, well, aren't you ashamed of what people might think about you? And he says, I'm not responsible for what other people think, only for who I am. So this character, he has inner strength, and he will do good, even if that means he must fight. On the other side is the villain, I didn't find a picture of him, but he thinks he's a tough guy. But he respects nothing. He betrays friend and family. He takes what he wants. He delights in preying upon those weaker than him. He is a stalker, a kidnapper, a thief, a liar. He's just despicable in every way. And of course, he thinks that the hero is a coward because they're so different. And at the end of the movie, they face each other in a classic duel, one shot only. You know, so you turn, step out, march out across, turn upon the command, turn, and upon the command, fire. But the villain does not wait for the command to fire. He reaches out and, tries to sneak a shot in before the command's given. But he misses. He only grazes him. And the judge, of course, is outraged. But before action's taken, the hero says, no, wait, now it's my turn. And now the villain is helpless. He has to stand there helplessly while the hero takes his sweet time. Yeah, as you can see in the picture, this is that moment, him taking his sweet time, going, okay, I'm going to aim this shot perfectly. I don't have to make a quick shot. I can aim this right between your, and the villain can see the look on his face, the determination, like this guy is going to make sure he nails this shot. And at that point, his nerve fails him. He scrambles down on all fours and cowers, and then he scrambles away and hides. And the judge is calling, fire, shoot him. And the hero kind of turns sideways, lowers it, fires into the ground. The test of nerve has revealed the truth of their character. Everyone can see the villain for the coward he is. Everyone looks at the hero with newfound respect. So the test of nerves has revealed the truth. And you will face tests of nerve, tests of strength, tests of character in your life. And your choices probably won't be as severe as will I stand tall or will I cower like a dog. But you will have common tests every day. Tests of, will you take courage or will you lose heart? Will you do good or will you do nothing? Will you speak or will you be silent? Will you cling to God? Or will you let mockery and the cares of this world peel you away from God? So it takes inner strength to be faithful and to not lose heart. And Ephesians 3 that we're looking at today teaches us where your inner strength comes from. And verse 13, the Apostle Paul asked believers to not lose heart over his suffering. So don't lose heart over the opposition of the world to Christ and to his church. And for this, to not lose heart, you need spiritual strength. And so in this chapter, verses 1 through 13, the Apostle Paul reminds us that our confidence comes from what Christ has done for us. And then in verses 14 through 21, he teaches how God works spiritual strength in so verse 1 of chapter 3 here begins with, for this reason. And his for this reason is a review of the two previous chapters. That's his reason. And the two previous chapters summed up super fast are, in love, Christ, that God, he chose you to be redeemed through Christ. Believers received this when they heard the gospel of the forgiveness of sins in Christ and they believed it. You were dead in sins, but God in his great love made you alive in Christ. And this spiritual renewal, it makes all Christians, Jew or Gentile, every nation, one united people. And God is building us up together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. So that is the for this reason. I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory. So we have bold confidence through our faith in what Christ has done for us. It says, through the riches of Christ, Gentile believers are fully God's people. They, and therefore we, don't think any of us here are direct genealogical sons of Abraham here. We could put ourselves right there with them. We are not accepted as we are, but the gospel is offered to us just as we are. And when we are in Christ by faith, we are fully accepted on account of his righteousness. And God sent the apostles to declare the gospel. That's history. That's fact. God revealed this to Paul through direct revelation. And when you reread Ephesians, as we've been covering the last two chapters before this, you perceive Paul's intimate understanding of the gospel of Christ, of God's plan to save us in Jesus. And so therefore, because of all this, we have confidence. We might suffer afflictions and persecutions, but all these are temporary losses. None of these upset God's eternal purpose in the least. They cannot undo what Christ has done for you. And so therefore, we have confident boldness in the face of adversity. God's work for us is certain, but we are not fully formed yet. We've been made spiritually alive, but we need spiritual strengthening. And that's got to continue in every believer's heart so that this boldness, this confidence becomes part of who you are. And verses 14 through 21 then describe how God strengthens your heart. So verse 14 through 16, for this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being. So these verses teach us how God strengthens you. So first, pray for it. The Apostle Paul prayed this for you. You can pray it for yourself. And the strength, it's in your being. So that means in your heart, your mind, your soul, your spirit, the center of who you are, your intellect, your emotions, and especially your will. And your inner being, this was all born again when you became a Christian. So you have a new spiritual life. And Paul prayed that this spiritual life, it would be strengthened with power. Power to exert itself. And so you should be flexing that new spiritual strength, that strength from the Spirit, the new spiritual person, flex it. Because this power he is giving through the Spirit, it is meant to be used. It wants to grow and exert itself. So I think of it, I mean, we could illustrate it so many ways. It's like the plants in early spring here in Minnesota, because boy, when you come to May and suddenly things just grow and bloom so fast. And so it's like that plant who's ready, like, hey, I'm ready to grow. I'm going to bloom and sprout like you never saw before. Or I think of it like the racehorse who's at he's stomping the dirt, he's chomping at the bit, he wants to go. Let's run with all our might. Or think of it like the football player on the line who's waiting for the hike. He's eyeballing the guy on the opposite line saying, let's go. This is that strength that wants to be used. Power for the strengthening of your spirit. So likewise, that the new spiritual life planted in you is strengthened with power to assert itself. And the Holy Spirit, he uses the Word of God and the sacraments to strengthen you. And God's Word, first of all, it shows us where we need to change. Psalm 139, 23 and 24 says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. So I mean, there's each of us, we look at your inward self. Where do you lose heart? Where do you lose will? When are you silent when you should speak? What passions do you impulsively act upon when you should show self-control? What good have you not followed through on to do? God's law will reveal your error, but his word will also transform your heart. Romans 12:2 says, Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And 2 Corinthians 4:16 says, so we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. So God will transform your inner being by his word and spirit. And God transforms you and he strengthens you to according to the Spirit. James 2 says that faith without works is dead, and that faith is completed by his works. So it takes strength to follow Christ. It takes strength to confess wrong. It takes strength to repent. It takes strength to control your own impulses and reactions. It takes strength, you know, to not give an eye for an eye, or to not smash your birdhouse on the floor. It takes strength, you know, to do good when it costs you something. It takes strength to call out deceptions and declare truths that no one wants to hear. It takes strength to persevere, to be faithful to the end, to cling to God above all else. And this inner strength comes from God's Spirit in you by Christ. And this is something he wants to do. This is him doing it. He graciously grants it to all who are in Christ by faith. And the strengthening, the spiritual strengthening, it's not the end in of itself. It is leading somewhere. We come to verse 17. Strengthened so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Now, Apostle Paul, he is talking to believers, so he does not mean Christ entering your hearts. He's talking about Christ continually dwelling in your heart. And when Rachel and I closed on our house, you know, that house was ours. We owned it. We had the rights to it at that point. But we didn't transform every space, you know, every inch of the house on day one, right? It took some time. In fact, you know, since then, we've two more children have been born. We've rearranged a lot of furniture. There we've replaced a furnace, and there are still boxes we have not unpacked. And so we're not done. We will continually change our house as we dwell in it. And likewise, Christ will dwell in you. Because when you put your faith in Christ for salvation, he became Lord of your life. And yet his transforming you is not completed in an instant. He's going to change your mind, your heart, emotions, and will as he dwells in you. And so the question is, are you letting him? Are you letting his word lead you and correct you and teach you and transform you? Because what he wants to do within each heart is a complete remodeling. He is not just there to redecorate. He must knock out the rotting frames so that he can strengthen you inside, so that your heart, your mind, your soul can bear the purposes that he's called you to. The old heart weakened by sin cannot do the good deeds of God. So Christ must strengthen you within so that he can more fully dwell in you as Lord of the house. So he must transform your mind so that you perceive clearly. He must transform your conscience so that you discern rightly. He must transform and he must tame the emotions so that they fuel your motivation for righteousness instead of enslaving you to passions. And he must strengthen your will to act in obedience to God. And the Spirit strengthens you so that Christ may dwell within you through faith. All this is by faith. He enters by faith. He dwells by faith. And as you trust that Jesus is the Christ, that he is your Savior and your friend, and as you say to him, you know, thy will be done, then he will transform you inside in a blessed way. Verse 17 continues, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. So, strengthened by the Spirit, Christ dwelling within by faith, we become rooted and grounded in Jesus' love for us and our love for him. You become rooted like a tree planted in good soil whose roots grow deep and the tree grows strong and tall and flourishes. And you grow within as your soul is rooted in love for God. And this love for God, it grows as you see him more clearly. The better you see him, the more clearly, the more deeply you will love him. And that clear sight of Jesus, that grows as you get to know him in his word and in your relationship with him. So feed on his word and feed on him. Let him feed your soul. And then as you are rooted in love, you will be strengthened to know God's love for you. The love of Christ, it is the nuclear reactor of your spiritual strength. It surpasses all knowledge. It cannot be fully known. He says he is strengthening you to know it. And his description here is really amazing because he describes it in four dimensions. He says breadth and height and length and depth. God's love has dimensions that we cannot comprehend on our own. And yet you are being strengthened to know the love of Christ more deeply and to be filled with all the fullness of God. He says you will be filled with him, with his love, his wisdom, his righteousness, his strength. And you'll be filled up, you are finite, obviously. You will be filled up to the capacity that a mortal human soul can be filled. But the importance here is that the love of Christ is the strength of your soul. His love it's the beginning and end of your salvation. His love wins you. It wins your faith to him. You trust in his love. And his love, it transforms your soul and it strengthens your soul. It is your life. And so I just want to close listening to these words of God's love, reminding us from different passages of Scripture. Ephesians 1, 4, and 5. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2, 4, and 5. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. 1 John 4, 9 and 10. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Romans 8, 35 and 37. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? So tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And what we heard earlier, Psalm 145, the Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. So God strengthens you by his love to be boldly confident in his love. And all this is from Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. And because of Christ's love, we can joyfully proclaim with Psalm 118, the Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. And we can praise God with the Apostle Paul. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we can ask or think, according to the power at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this word today. I pray for each of us here, this prayer of Paul, that you would grant every one of us to be strengthened in the Spirit, that Christ would dwell in us by faith, that we would be strengthened to know the love of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. And Chris is going to lead us here in our closing worship song.
Take the sin and darkness from me.
please stand for the benediction. From 2 Thessalonians 2, 16 and 17. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who has loved us and given us eternal comfort and good hope by grace, comfort and strengthen your hearts in every good work and word. Amen. You all have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. And if you have, there are coffee and donuts in the fellowship hall. Please join us.